Hello, everyone, and welcome to our webinar today entitled Zero Trust, the Complete Picture. My name is Carol Alexander, and I'm the head of Identity Security Product Marketing, and I'll be your moderator today. Before we get started, I just wanted to go through a few housekeeping items. First of all, please, if you'd like to ask a question, we're open to asking questions and we'd like to have a discussion. So please type your question here and then we'll answer all of these questions at the end of the session. If we can't get to them, we'll certainly send the answers out to everyone. Secondly, we have uploaded some collateral for you and some other webinars and white paper. So that if you'd like to download those, please go to the attachment section. And please also at the end of this, please rate this presentation. That always helps us improve. And again, if you'd like to watch this webinar is being recorded. So if you want to watch it over again, or you have colleagues that would like to watch it, please use the same link to access the recording of today's webinar. Okay, so here we are, everyone. Really nice to have you here today. What I'd like to do now is introduce Vadim Lander. And Vadim is a highly recognized, he's our CTO and distinguished engineer, I should say, for identity security at Broadcom. He's a very recognized IAM expert, having architected, developed, and led multiple highly scalable IAM solutions to become industry leaders. Many of you probably know Vadim as the architect of SiteMinder for Integrity, where he designed the architecture and ran SiteMinder engineering. And he joined CA when CA acquired Integrity. And of course, now being part of Broadcom, as well as being part of Symantec. So we're part of our Symantec divisions. At Oracle, he also was the architect of and the design, excuse me, for the implementation of multi-tenant, microservice-based, multi-regional cloud identity service to secure Oracle IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS services. And so here at Broadcom, Vadim is focused on evolving IAM to meet the needs of the world going digital. So with that introduction, let's get started. Vadim, the floor is all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Carol. And hello, folks. Great to have you on the webinar. Okay, so why don't we get started? So we're going to talk a bit about zero trust, right? What it really means. What is the architecture of zero trust, you know, various scenarios. And we're going to talk a bit about sort of kind of the identity management, digital identity management that sort of helps zero trust reach its goals. So it's not going to be a network only zero trust presentation, so we'll focus a lot on the application infrastructure as well. So why zero trust, right? I'm sure you are on this webinar thinking about it, because otherwise you wouldn't be here. So we live in a world where we don't necessarily trust everybody, right? That's ultimately what the issue is. And living in this world where we're dealing with compromised identities, you know, for example, Verizon's recent report has, you know, 80% of breaches involves, you know, brute force, some other kinds of attacks, right? So our identities are not secure, right? And they can be stolen. We live in a world where we consume different kinds of devices, right? We deal with, you know, anywhere from my wearable device, you know, where I'm transacting, you know, banking, you know, withdrawals, for example, or transfers, all the way to, you know, service, right? So devices compromised, where, you know, brute force or through, you know, privileged, you know, personnel that are, you know, for some reason or another, trying to hack their way into the system. And of course, because of the business, right? You know, one of the great examples of the business requiring zero trust is that how we are basically migrating our business to the cloud, right? You know, we've went from a network perimeter, we started consuming cloud services, we now have these services everywhere, we're moving to the cloud, we have applications born in the cloud. So managing this transition securely, and then not only managing the transition, but managing kind of a secure end state requires zero trust. So what is it, right? What is zero trust? A little bit of a history. I remember going back maybe 2005 when the Jericho Forum basically declared that the perimeter was dead. I think they were a little early, but you know, that made a great headline. And that basically that the infrastructure was, you know, started to look like cheese, right? Everything was port 80. The firewall was declared by Jericho Forum to be ineffective at that point. So they were obviously very early, but they made a good point that as perimeter started to disappear, right, we need to start applying more and more controls to ensure that as we progress across various applications, ecosystems, and enable us as identities or things to consume resources and get access to more and more applications, there would have to be more control. And so folks like Forrester, for example, coined the zero trust term to represent a methodology, right, that enables us to transact the business securely. And really this methodology is based on never trust, always verify principle, which is a really good, actually good way to live your life as well, right? You know, who do you know? How do you trust them? So verify every user, verify every device, right? You know, and transact a business with a least privilege, and assume breach, right? Assume that you're going to be breached. Try to contain that breach. You know, like for example, like we build ships, right? Lots and lots of different compartments, right? And so the model, the zero trust model, is a data-centric model, right? That is centered on the fact that we don't trust anything that is going on inside or outside of our perimeters, right? And that we address the movement of identities or of applications, right? You know, by basically leveraging a policy infrastructure, you know, based on user context, very important, application context, and device context. So in general, context becomes critical to establishing trust, right? Under certain context, there's very little trust, and under some other context, there's a lot of trust. So, you know, so we're starting to sort of approach how the real physical world is operating. So let's take a look, right? So, you know, as people using devices, you know, over the network, trying to access some applications, right? The zero trust is about having that policy, having that risk-based policy that takes the context I just talked about and applies controls depending on the context, right? A lot of this context is going to be risk-based. This is, again, how we live our lives. Sometimes we take a lot of risk and sometimes we take very little risk. And so we measure how we handle this on the basis of risk. So as people, whether it's employees, you know, customers, or, you know, bots, devices, whether it's our wearables, IoT, servers, you know, or mobile devices, network, whether it's a public or managed, we need to be able to verify, right, as these conditions take place, right, the verification that the contextually policies have to deal with, right, we'll then start looking at various kinds of context components, such as who are you, you know, where it's a role-based, where it's an, where it's a attribute-based ABAC or RBAC, two models, you know, what kind of identity are you, you know, the health of the device, you know, whether it's a managed, unmanaged, is it secure, does it have the latest antivirus signatures, for example. The network, right? Is it a known network or unknown network? Is it in a specific geolocation? So different, you know, coordinates and the components of the network infrastructure. And of course, the applications themselves, right? You know, everything's an app. Infrastructure is also an app. What is the sensitivity of the application? Is it an ERP app? You have to be pretty certain that, you know, anybody who is, you know, putting in a significant purchase order is has the right level of risk, right? You know, where's it running? How, what are the governance conditions around the application? You know, and it doesn't matter if it's, on-premise app or PaaS infrastructure or SaaS infrastructure, the rules still apply. And ultimately, the context that we determine, right, based on, you know, various rules is what is the level of risk, right, that we're willing to take, right? What is the threat level, right? What do we observe? What is the behavior that these identities or devices or applications are exhibiting, right? Are there anomalies, right? Sometimes you say, I don't really care, you know, kind of what's going on as long as it's consistent with what I've been seeing before. And if there's an anomaly, I want that to be identified and then I want it to be brought into my risk equation so I can say, hey, if there's an anomaly, that creates a risk for me and then I deal with that, right? And so the zero trust model really is about this circle over here, right? Having the right context, typically a risk-based context, right? What are the controls that have to be in place? Where do you allow? Where do you block? Where you allow but require additional constraints? So this is exactly where multi-factor authentication comes in. You know, do you audit? Do you encrypt? You know, what are the terms of conditions? So under what conditions, which is context, what kinds of controls do you require in order for identities, you know, have access to their resources or for things to be able to access the resource. So this is over here. It's kind of the magic of zero trust, you know, being able to acquire contexts, translate these contexts to something that's manageable, and then through a policy declaration, through security policy declaration, right, define the kinds of controls you need and or want, right, from your governance perspective. Let's take a look at a couple of examples. So first we have a regular employee, right, that's using a healthy, you know, seems to be a healthy device. The device is reporting, device is running some agent, the agent is reporting that it's healthy, it has the latest antivirus, and, you know, you happen to be in a corporate network. Again, doesn't matter whether you're inside. Not many of us are inside today, whether it's you in a VPN, but you know, a corporate network is, right? And so the usual behavior, right, basically defines a low risk. So then from the policy perspective, we say, okay, so what does it mean from the low risk perspective? Well, allow, right? Allow this identity, this transaction, this request to go through, right? Provided there's a regular, let's say in this particular case, let's say it's an FTE. So a passwordless login, okay, to access the corporate portal. So this is not anything different from the norm under normal conditions, just allow. A second scenario, for example, you have a manager, right? The manager is trying to access, let's say this is a sales manager, trying to access a CRM system, look at their geography, right? And so they happen to, for example, you know, take an hour, go to Starbucks, or this was maybe not now, but you know, somewhere no longer in the corporate world. You know, they have not updated their device yet. They doesn't have the latest AVs. So the system determines, right, again, based on the context, right, determines that there's a potential vulnerability. Potential vulnerability may be related to the fact that a device doesn't have the latest AV and therefore reporting, you know, less than the normal device posture. Maybe the fact that this particular access point, you know, has been known to have been breached, you know, before, and therefore it's not, you know, the scan reports that there's a potential vulnerability. So in this particular case, from the governance perspective, this is not an overly sensitive application, right? This is not an application that is governed by many regulations. And so the policy decides, right, that it's a medium risk, right? And with a medium risk, we will still allow access. However, we will always require MFA, right? And that's as opposed to saying, okay, why don't we just ask for your MFA once for some factor and then allow you to, as you remember, trust this device or remember this device. We will not do that. We will always require MFA, right? So that when you're under these conditions, right, you just simply need to step up and always step up in order to access CRM. So this is a reasonable definition, for example, in the taxonomy of risk of a medium risk that one could come up with. The last example here that I have is an ERP example. So here we have a purchaser. So the purchaser, you know, has the privilege, right, in the ERP system to submit a purchase order, you know, maybe for $1 million, you know, maybe for $20, doesn't really matter what it is. But fundamentally, the issue to look for here in this kind of zero trust situation is looking for anomalies, right? So everything, device is healthy, network is healthy, you know, there's, you know, the person itself is, you know, active and whatnot. However, you've observed, right, the system observes that there was a recent change to a privilege level, right? So yesterday, right, the privileges all of a sudden got escalated for this particular identity. And now today we're seeing that there's an abnormally high purchase order, purchase amount, right? This particular individual has never submitted the purchase order this high. So a reasonable way of looking at this situation is say, hey, I'm determining an anomaly, right? There was a privilege escalation, right, or privilege elevation, and an abnormally high purchase amount. That is a high risk. Something is going on. Now, maybe totally legit, but we need to investigate, right? And so the system now, again, risk-based policy says, okay, I've got the context. What is the control? Well, from the control perspective, we would want to block. We want to, you know, file a ticket, and we would want to then investigate this particular ticket to see whether it's a legitimate or not. And if it is legitimate, we would then unblock, and then we would remember the fact that it is legitimate, and then we won't go back to it. So fundamentally, you know, the system that enables you to codify your risk in terms of, let's say, low, medium, or high is a good way of dealing with various contextual conditions that could then be plugged into the risk-based policy in order to make the final determination of how you want to control the outcome. Okay, so let's look at the architecture. This is the Forrester's perspective. I think they've done a really good job with this. And so on a sort of from the end-to-end perspective, right, the IT infrastructure or whatever the application infrastructure you've got is relatively complex, right? We've got identities. You know, who are we, right? Who are these real identities, carbon identities? These may be, you know, bots. These may be things, right? Lots of identities are now floating around. There are devices. There are corporate devices. There are personal devices. There are managed devices. There are unmanaged devices. There is obviously a lot of app infrastructure, right? There is the apps in the cloud. There's on-premise apps. There is cloud on-premise. Through cloud in the box, there's data all over the place, including structured data and unstructured data. There's infrastructure itself that has become important, right? As we started to pick up clouds and public clouds, we're now having to think of this infrastructure or PaaS or even SaaS as extensions of our own infrastructure, and therefore they become extensions of our own governance, right? The cloud provider is not really responsible for who you allow access to their resources. You are responsible, right? And so even though you are using somebody else's infrastructure, the responsibility for the governance and what happens there is still with us. Of course, the network is there, right? And so various ways kind of figuring out, right, security policy, performing the security policy enforcement is a sort of relatively sort of sophisticated thing, and you need an ecosystem, right? Almost like a platform, right, to be able to act on this effectively. So here I've listed some solution areas. So for example, thinking about how to manage that context, right? How to identify what is going on so that we can then plug them into the policy, various kinds of policies. Well, who are we is typically addressed by authentication. So multi-factor authentication, you know, various policy for how to properly identify you. The endpoint and the health of the endpoint, right? The endpoint security solution deals with this. Unmanaged devices, there are now techniques to deal with that through mirror gateway technologies. The data itself, whether it's a structured data or unstructured data or cloud applications, the email gateways, the cloud access security brokers. Identity management obviously is one of such security capabilities, right? Protecting access to various applications, you know, on-prem, providing federation services. The software-defined perimeter is a new area that has emerged in a few years back, right? You know, kind of extending the security perimeter, extending the security capability out to the cloud, you know, resources, you know, web gateways, kind of, you know, managing and enforcing access. So, of course, you know, thinking about this, right, together, you want this sort of global intelligence, right? The global intelligence for all of this sort of to be a platform, right, to make sure that instead of sort of the point-to-point integrations between these various solutions, that there is some sort of consistency across these capabilities to help identify, right, and manage common threats. So, so this architecture obviously continues to evolve. It probably continues to get more complicated as we continue to add more more perimeters and more systems. And so the what we do in each of these areas and how we tie this back to the various contexts and policies will continue to evolve. But that doesn't change the fact that in your sort of from the framework perspective, your zero trust architecture has to have an element of security policy enforcement where you can begin to make decisions about, you know, what is risk, so that you can apply risk across the board. What is a session, so that you can apply that session across the board? What is the identity, right? So you can apply and use that identity across the board. So even though the data and resources are different, the elements that typically that don't really change from the sort of the, your core capability perspective is the identity, is the session, is the risk itself that you need to continuously measure and apply in each of these areas. So, what does it really mean, right? So fundamentally, right, the role of security in zero trust has shifted, right? It's a shift in how we approach identity security, right? We're now talking about, in order for us to be able to manage, right, this ecosystem of any identity on any device, right, or through any device, being able to access any application, we have to have risk-aware continuous policy and session management across the board. We have to be able to identify all users that are trying to access the data. That's where the authentication identity assurance comes from, right? We need to be able to continuously authorize, no matter where the identities are trying to go or what resources are being accessed, right? We need to continuously authorize based on the level of risk and data sensitivity, right? Sometimes this will be a zero, right, on one extreme, no risk, data is absolutely non-sensitive, public resource, anybody can go get there, all the way to the other extreme, which is top secret, extremely risky, right? Very, very sensitive. We have to ensure that we then have the taxonomy for how we're able to sort of partition, you know, our resources and how we're able to partition the risk so we can perform this continuous authorization. And we, of course, as I mentioned before, the purpose of the outcome of ZT is that what do? We automatically adjust or block access. We can allow, we can deny, or we can adjust. We say, we'll allow access, but you must accept terms and conditions. We'll allow access, but you need to step up. We'll allow access, but we need to downgrade your privileges because we don't necessarily trust you to be able to do this, right? There's an anomaly. I will let you do that, but I only let you do something in read-only mode and not in update mode, for example. So what is being adjusted and what is being allowed, what is being blocked, of course, is a policy decision. And then, of course, this is all being monitored, right, to ensure that the accounts, credentials, and various other artifacts, such as keys and whatnot, right, under lock and key, the vaults should make sure that the information should not and cannot leak out. That would basically prevent this kind of evaluation here, right? And of course, then the final, last but not the least, is that coming back to the identity, you know, we need to constantly govern the level of user access, right, to enforce the least privilege model. Why do you have so many entitlements? Who gave you those entitlements? Or have you been using those entitlements? And if you're not using those entitlements, you shouldn't have them, right? They should be removed. So being able to, being able to have the right systems in place to always continuously authorize and adjust on the access management side, on the identity management side, being able to govern the level of user entitlements, on the privilege access management side, being able to secure and govern access to these highly sensitive accounts, right? All of this needs to be in place. And of course, everything starts with the identity, right? Who are you, right? How and what is the level of assurance that is required in order to positively and securely and effectively identify you? So this is really the shift in how we approach identity security. It stems from wanting to practice zero trust, but it also enables zero trust, right? Which ultimately is about enabling secure access, for any of these identities to any of these applications. So, an interesting area that some of you may not have thought about it is that the tokenization of trust is a key component of zero trust architecture. Why is that, right? It is because zero trust architecture says always verify, never trust, always verify. Well, how often do we do that, right? So let's assume that the trust being granted for a day. So does it mean that it will verify once a day? Well, that may be okay in some cases and probably not okay in many other cases. So by tokenizing the trust, by tokenizing your session, by reducing the duration between evaluation, reevaluation of risk, and reevaluation of trust, right, we're able to dramatically increase the efficacy of our security capabilities. So the tokenization of trust is a way, for example, applications, the modern applications are being built using new standards such as tokenizing it through, OAuth, through OpenID, and other kinds of standards. And rather than thinking in terms of, I have long-lasting sessions, right, during which anything can happen. My session can be stolen, my credential can be stolen, my risk can be elevated, right? A lot can happen. The goal of these architectures is to actually break down the session into a smaller number of sessions, which we call tokens. These tokens typically are 5-minute tokens, 10-minute tokens, 60-minute tokens, right? It depends on what what is acceptable. But now by breaking things down into tokens, we're able to apply our authorizations. We're able to measure risk on a much more ongoing basis. An application, an example that I had provided previously, somebody accessing an ERP application does not get a session for 8 hours. What they do instead is the application, the clients get a token, let's say for 60 minutes. And then every 60 minutes, the token has to be updated. And so once the tokens are updated and re-requested, the authorization comes into the picture. We again come back to the policy decision and ask the question, do you have the right level of risk? Is this an anomaly? And we continuously measure and we continuously enforce your right to access a particular application. So authorization comes into the picture. Risk now comes into the picture. The sessions are becoming, even though from the usability perspective, you think it's a continuous session, but actually under the covers, we're checking your credentials, your risk. We're checking your authorizations much, much more frequently. So the role of risk management, the role of risk service becomes much more critical. The role of authentication service becomes much more critical. The role of authorization and session as discrete individual capabilities your organization would use to manage zero trust architecture become a lot more critical because they are being leveraged a lot more often. And so instead of, for example, looking at the risk every 8 hours, we now look at risk every 1 hour in this architecture. Now, there's a point of diminishing return. You cannot necessarily make it every 30 seconds, right? There will be too much going on, too much chattiness, but you can significantly reduce the footprint of the risk of the attack by starting to look and implementing a tokenization of trust capabilities, which is exactly why and how a crop of really good standards have emerged over the last five, seven years. Okay. One thing I want to talk about is an interesting innovation. So we just talked about, you know, zero trust and how tokenization of trust can reduce the attack vector by reducing the time, by reducing the duration, right? By making the token smaller. So the innovation here that we as an industry have worked on, right, in the last three, four years, and some folks out there have this in production now, it's called Continuous Access Evaluation Protocol. And really what this does, it allows us to reduce that window of attack to basically seconds, sometimes microseconds, but sometimes seconds. And mostly seconds, right? And the reason for that is that because rather than thinking now in terms of hours for tokens or in terms of days for sessions, right? Now we're talking about signals, right? Signals that KPs enabled systems can exchange between one another to report a particular issue, right? And then act, and then the systems that are receiving these signals, right, that are well-defined based on now standard protocols, based on standard schemas. It enables these applications, it enables the applications, it enables identity providers to take action in real time and then modify the risk, update sessions, influence authorization in near real time, right? So we've gone from a world of sort of static, right, security to a very, very dynamic security that enables us to truly manage that zero trust, right? So for example, a couple of events that are extremely useful, for example, is a suspension, right? User account got suspended, right? An event is sent out, subscribing systems pick it up, and they deal with it immediately. They know that it is a suspension event, therefore they need to suspend that particular identifier and they need to drop whatever service that they are providing for that particular identifier. You see that a lot, even with user password changes, right? When an application is asking you to change the password, it sometimes, newer crop of apps ask you, do you want your session to be revoked as well? Because you don't want any other devices where you might have logged in to still be active. Whether the user risk is elevated, or MFA triggered or not, we actually had this particular example and use case demonstrated in my last webinar. User session logout or user session revoked is a great signal, right? That basically can then be picked up by the infrastructure, by all the applications that are participating in this ecosystem. What is a client application itself with the elevated risk or the client's identity has been stolen? And the interesting thing is it also enables trusted providers to be vouching for the identity. You know, for example, a mobile, you know, provider, right? Your phone, your mobile device has been stolen, right? So that actually, that mobile device has a lot of applications, right? And those applications have nothing to do with the mobile provider. They have to do with ERPs and CRM and your corporate network. So, you know, how do they find out that your mobile device has been stolen? So this architecture actually enables us as an industry to exchange trusted signals and therefore therefore influence security policy, right? Whether it's we harden the identity by requiring additional factors, or we simply block you. Or whether the application receiving a signal decides, you know what, you know, the session, your session's gone, so therefore you need, they need to stop the service. As well as we can discover on the fly what is going on and then have a more or less, you know, kind of learning mechanism for these security policies to understand what is going. So the notion to bringing this dynamic world of event management and signals into our zero trust, you know, architecture and foundation gives us almost near real time remediation to address issues. So it's a really good innovation. And let me give you a, kind of a more specific example here. So an identity provider that understands your identity, right? Typically, this is where we you know, we authenticate, right? So the a CAPE-enabled client typically accepts makes requests, right, to various applications, and in order to make these requests, right, they have to redeem a token. So they have to go somewhere to get a token. They typically go to one or more identity providers that are responsible for issuing tokens for these resource servers. So they will go to the identity provider. This is where we apply the policy, right? We apply the policy, we issue a token, okay? And then the applications clients use those tokens to access pretty much any kind of application. So the two kinds of policies that take place is one on the application side, and one on the identity side. So this is where, by exchanging security events, right, we're able to influence the policy. If this identity provider determines that user's risk has been elevated for whatever reason, they can notify, they can provide a security event, and then the subscribing entities will pick it up automatically, and they will then basically plug it into their policies, and the policies will determine that the risk is too high, for example, or the session's been revoked, or the identity, you know, has been disabled, right? And so this, they pick this up in real time. Same thing can happen on the other side. If the application determines that it's seeing an anomalous behavior, right? There's, you know, Vadim is doing something that he has never been doing and never done in this particular application, and is really behaving in a weird way, they can send a security event to the identity provider, and then the identity provider, you know, would have been configured with a matching policy to deal with that, and potentially maybe elevate if this is a trusted you know, application, and then the identity provider could then be configured to say, I trust this application, let me elevate Vadim's score a little bit so that the next time, right, tokens are requested, they will actually have, they will be issued with a higher risk score. And therefore, when the token with a higher risk score is presented to an application, the application next time may decide to not accept that particular token, or accept that particular token, but with the reduced level of access. So a lot of interesting possibilities this is giving us. Microsoft Azure has implemented this. This is in production. Google is in production. I believe that this infrastructure will actually become the norm in every single cloud, because a cloud, being a very large enterprise, has to provide us, the consumers of the cloud, with certain guarantees and capabilities that enables us to use that cloud as a big integrated platform. And I would recommend that for folks that are looking at zero trust architectures in their enterprises, that not only you look at zero trust solutions that manage individual sort of areas of ingress and egress, but you also look at tokenization of trust as an architectural pattern to follow in your strategy, as well as this now continuous access evaluation, right? That actually makes the systems more secure, and enables you to reduce your vectors of attack. Okay. So what did we learn, right? What did we go through, right? We talked about zero trust, and ultimately zero trust practiced well enables the shift to any identity, any device, any app. And whether you are a consumer, whether you are an employee, whether you're a partner or a vendor, whatever, right? We want this, right? We want to be able to leverage our great devices. We want to be able to, through self-service, to consume any kind of application, you know, anywhere, right? So we want this, but you need to enable us to practice this securely, right? You want to enable, you want to reduce the friction for the users, but you also want to ensure that you're, that it's being done securely. And zero trust architecture actually helps us reach this point. A set of solutions that are integrated through analytics and automation and intelligence, right, create a unified zero trust platform, right? This is both with a zero trust capable solutions that deal with, you remember that architecture, that deal with each of the ingress and egress points in a smart way by sharing intelligence, you know, by automating various events, you know, by understanding what's going on and creating analytics, which can then be used as input into various risk engines and policy engines, really creates a platform. And then so in your strategy, as you think about how you want the zero trust to be applied, you want to make sure that you look at it from the platform perspective, and then you move towards that platform, right, in an incremental fashion that makes sense in your environment. I made the case for tokenization of trust. It definitely supports your overall zero trust objectives by reducing the attack window. We're already seeing modern applications pick this up, right? The standards have evolved to support exactly this, and this is a really good thing to have in your arsenal to be able to, you know, manage both the security aspect of this, you know, user satisfaction, as well as agility, right? There's the one dimension that I haven't talked about here is that it actually enables your application development teams to be a lot more a lot more agile, right? And I'll finally, the innovation in this continuous access evaluation protocol, it finally brings the zero trust architecture home by saying it's not something you just implement and then and see how it works. Hey, it actually becomes almost real time, right? You actually, zero trust truly becomes close to near real time zero so that you can practice this effectively. So our quick value proposition before we get to questions, right? Obviously an integrated cyber defense platform, right? It's a, as I talked about the platform, it's a very complete set of solutions. Total cost of ownership because of the platform, right? Either through licensing agreements or just because it's an integrated platform, right? The overall cost is lower. You get more. It's actually fits better, faster, cheaper, very, very well. And it's really it really does what it's supposed to do. It does the job. It deals with various security related issues, identity related issues. So please, when you get a chance, take a look at this. We will follow up with another set of webinars that actually demonstrate, right? Now that I'm going to do in the next set of webinars, I will demonstrate these solutions, right? Some of these solutions working together to show how zero trust is actually deployed and practiced in real world, both in terms of the policy and security architecture, in terms of tokenization of trust, risk management, session management, as well as the newer innovation that I talked about from the continuous access evaluation perspective to make zero trust truly be zero trust, which it was intended to be in the first place. With that, I want to hand it off to Carol, and we have some time for Q&A.
So I put us back on screen, Vadim. So let me just start with the questions here. The first one, which is pretty interesting, which I seem to ask you a lot, how is zero trust different from SASE?
Zero trust is really about it's really continuous authorization. It's whether it's a network layer or application layer or identity layer, it doesn't really matter. And so zero trust is basically living the life based on risk. You know, whether you take, you know, do you go out at night? Depends. So that's the decision you make. And the corporation practicing zero trust makes certain decisions based on the sensitivity and applicability of their applications. They define the policies and they decide, right, how do and when do those policies kick in, and even more importantly, what the action should be. The actions also, you know, as I mentioned, quite different, right? They can be all the way from I will block, I will allow, but I will allow with conditions. Conditions may be I'll allow you read-only access, right? I'll allow you complete access, or I'll downgrade you, right? So it really depends. So it's about this continuous assessment of risk on one side and the action on the other side. And when you put it together, you basically say, listen, it's the policy that's driving my decisions.
And how's that different than SASE? How does that differ from SASE?
I think it's mostly in the area of kind of the identity and authorization policies
that are coming
into the picture here. It's the authorization policy is a governance condition, and the defining the right, you know, kind of policy for the right kind of application is you know one of these differences.
Okay. Now I have a couple of questions that are around like integrating my consumer point of view. I thought of zero trust as more toward internal, the corporate, and does this also apply to my apps that are customer facing in essence?
Sure, that's a great question. It does apply. It's not as pronounced, but it does apply. I'll give you an example. So we as employees, we have access to all sorts of resources, right? You know, we walk through the door, or we go through the virtual door, and we can access portals and applications, and you know, we can, you know, come up with various ways of, you know, elevating our privileges and keeping them. So there's a lot more ways we as let's say employees of an enterprise can get to various kinds of resources. As a consumer, we have less, right? Consumer applications are very, very static in their nature. They only give us what they're supposed to give us. A banking application will let me transact checking or savings, right? And you know, I'm not stepping into somebody's server. However, even within the consumer application, there's an element of trust, right? You can see that with a multi-factor authentication. You can see that with ongoing risk management, right? So that if I step away, or I move to another location, these apps can determine, you know, what happens. So it's mostly centered around me, mostly centered around the risk of my authentication. Not as much as, you know, access that I have to various credentials or whatnot. So it's looking for breach through the front door and then ongoing risk assessment, as opposed to always thinking potentially where I could be going and what systems I could be using.
Okay. Now there's a question around privileged access management versus just plain access management. And since they're different policies, how do they fit into this scheme?
Privileged access management. Yeah. So there's an access policy. Right, and the access policy is a language of authorization, right? Under what conditions do we allow you to continue, and then how do we do so, right? And so that's basically based on the business need and based on what you're trying to do, what is your business need, and then what are the security regulations that are governing these kinds of requests. Privileged account management, on the other hand, is a policy management area also, but what it's trying to do is it's trying to safeguard access to credentials that are necessary for systems and people to perform sensitive operations.
Okay. I think you answered this already, but I'll ask it anyway. It's how widely adopted is, how do you pronounce that? CAPE?
Continuous Access Enforcement Protocol.
Yeah.
It's starting to get adopted, right? As I mentioned, Microsoft has woven it into the fabric of its, Azure AD infrastructure, right? So we'll be seeing a lot of it in Azure. Google Cloud has started taking advantage of that as well, and has enabled application developers to create CAPE-enabled applications that can start, that can exchange these signals, right? And we will start seeing identity management vendors and other kinds of, and pretty much anybody that has a policy infrastructure will start taking a closer look at it, because they need to deal with these kinds of events, right? You know, whereas in the past, the message of accounts being disabled or session being revoked were custom integrations, right? There were, and it's very difficult in this any identity, any device, any application to have custom integrations in order to accurately track and capture this kind of information. So open standards, well-known schemas, pretty well-known defined schemas go a long way towards enabling interoperability across disparate systems.
Okay, here's a pretty detailed question, so I'm gonna try to read it carefully. How much aggregation into a trust score makes sense? Is it not better to have the atomic attribute signals to be checked by the access control system? And then what are your recommendations when to calculate pre-aggregated trust indexes?
There's a couple. I personally seen both extremes, right? It all depends on, I think, on the size of the architecture, right? On the size of the infrastructure. The larger the infrastructure, the more normative forms you have to have, right? You need to large infrastructures and scales well when you have well defined terms such as low risk, high risk, medium risk, which is why, for example, in government environments that are very sort of complicated, dot matrix, we deal with taxonomy where it's public, secret, top secret, on a need to know basis. So there's fewer identifiers, and so we choose the taxonomy. We choose the simpler taxonomy to scale. If you have smaller infrastructure where you're able to actually manage, what you mean by score of 80 or by score of 50, and then you're able to manage, you're able to understand, manage, and support on an ongoing basis changes to those definitions, then you can get, more precise results, right? And you may have, fewer, for example, denials. But unfortunately, it doesn't scale, right? So as you scale, you need to have more well-defined, taxonomy, and it helps the organization scale across all dimensions.
Okay. Next question is, how is AI playing a role in zero trust?
AI plays a role in zero trust by being able to detect anomalies, right? I've used an example where a system has detected that the purchase order amount that I've put into the ERP system is not something that I've used before. It's greatly exceeded my normal pattern. So being able to detect patterns and being able to use those patterns right in your policy evaluation is very important to help both the usability of the approach and the security of the system. One interesting example is with the identity governance, right? When somebody is requesting through self-service, requesting privileges, right? How different are those privileges from the peer group, right? And so being able to understand that whatever you're requesting is very consistent with your peer group, why don't we just automatically approve that? Right, so you're happy, the manager's happy, nothing to sign, nothing to review, you get to do what you need to do right away. But on the other hand, if the request is outside the scope of your peer group, well, something is different. So maybe totally legit, but now we need to double check. So the governance, the attestation, certification can then become much more automated, much more self-service oriented, keeping all of us happy and all of us more secure.
Okay. Are there any best practices and frameworks related to zero trust?
Yes, there is. I've talked about policy. So, Forrester has done a really good job articulating a framework. It's the framework of policy decisions, acquiring contexts, allowing, denying, stepping up, or whatnot. Gartner has a similar architecture, but at the end of the day, they all come down to the same thing, right? It's about being able to understand the context of what is going on, right? Being able to translate context into a set of contextual elements that are easily understood and are easily aggregatable into policies where you can then begin to make those decisions.
Okay, and the last question I have here is, can we integrate this, I'm assuming, into or with Symantec EDR?
Yes, you will be able to, yes. And this is something that I'm actually planning to demo in follow-up sessions.
Okay, awesome. Well, with that, let me get to the end of this presentation, and I'll bring up this slide. So Vadim mentioned that he has done several webinars. We did a series that is now on demand that you can see here, and the links to these are in your attachments. So if you'd like to learn more about the whole decentralized identity platform, zero trust, operationalizing this, please go back and take a listen to those. We also have a series of web chats between our GM, Clayton Donnelly, and Merritt Maxim from Forrester on privileged users and zero trust. So that should be in your attachments. And then Vadim will be doing another series starting in the new year, another live series. So be looking for that. We'll be advertising that shortly, and we'll continue on the journey to making zero trust a reality. Let me see. Oh, we did the Q&A. So I wanted to thank everyone. I wanted to remind you, please rate this presentation today. Again, that helps us, shape our presentations in the future. Please take a look at these webinars that Vadim has done and that we have for you. And I just wanted to thank everybody for attending, and please have a great day.